Hello, Blazers. Welcome to episode 17 of UAB Green and Told, original air date Monday, April 13th, 2020. Through this podcast, we are able to share stories from members of the UAB family. I'm Greg Barry, Assistant Director in the UAB Office of Alumni Affairs. Today, Dr. Qin Wang joins us, professor in the Department of Cell, Developmental and Integrative Biology. Like many children who grew up in China more than three decades ago, Qin had a good idea of what her career path was going to be.
When I was little, you know, during the time I grew up, it's a huge wave about science. So our dream was like to become a scientist.
That dream became reality, first getting her PhD at Iowa, then completing her postdoc at Vanderbilt. But it was here at UAB where her long, hard work really paid off.
We started, you know, about like a little over 10 years ago, we started this project.
Now, Qin and her team's research can boast a big breakthrough when it comes to Alzheimer's disease.
Based on our current result, or you know, what we have already learned, we're pretty confident, you know, this is an important mechanism for Alzheimer's.
From the neurofibrillary tangle research by Dr. Skip Bender to studies of functional decline in financial capacity by Dr. Dan Marson, UAB has enjoyed a long and distinguished history in Alzheimer's research. And now, we're back at it. Earlier this year, Dr. Qin Wang and her team revealed a key missing piece of the Alzheimer's disease puzzle. But before we get to the breakthrough, we have to understand the journey it took for Dr. Wang to get to where she is. And that starts as a little child in China.
Interested in science. I would say just a normal kid. and good at, of course, like math and science, you know, STEM, typical STEM kid, I guess I would say. And I don't feel like I'm any special.
At what point did you kind of set it as a goal, or at what point did you want to come to the U.S. and study?
Actually, I graduated from college. That was early 90s. Okay. At that time, I have to say, graduate study, you know, graduate schools, right, graduate training, United States is so much advanced than China. Of course, now they catch up a lot, but at you know back 25, almost 30 years ago, definitely this is a place to, if you want to become a real scientist, you want to go to U.S. to get the training.
Yeah.
Right. So that's actually a goal of a lot of a lot of us. You know, we share this kind of my husband and I we were actually classmates in college, and I have many friends like us. You know, we want to be scientists, and we know this is a place we get the authentic training.
When did you start getting interested in the brain?
I have to say, when I was little, during the time I grew up, it's a huge wave about science. So our dream was like to become a scientist. So that's like the biggest thing for a lot of people, like my friends, you know, a lot of us share this kind of dream. So that makes me always, want to get to the science field. And when I really got interested in brain was about really 15 years ago.
Okay.
When I started my own lab at UAB. So that's something about UAB, is a great environment. There's a lot of neurobiologists here. So many researchers working on brain, actually. They are very helpful, very supportive and collaborative. That's how I decided, to focus more on the neuroscience side. Of our research.
So what was it about the brain that really got you interested in that aspect of research?
So we have a general interest in our receptor function, say in a lot of different neuropsychiatric diseases, and we in the lab we're still working on aspects like related to major depression, for example. So the get to the Alzheimer's field is really driven by our research. So it's by the data. So because this receptor we're working on is really related to cognition. So you know, in Alzheimer's, the cognitive function got declined, right? Got impaired. So then the initially, you know, we have some very simple idea. Okay, so let's see whether this receptor is involved in the process, right? So then we find actually, if we knock out this receptor, there's in their brain they don't have this particular receptor, and we found a lot of improvement related to Alzheimer's disease phenotype. So then we got excited. So
yeah.
So why not? Let's figure out, you know, why is that, right? So what really the receptor functions, you know, in this whole disease process. So then we got dragged deeper and deeper.
So what is kind of the clinical definition of Alzheimer's?
I have to say the major symptom is cognitive decline. So this Alzheimer's disease is the major cause for dementia. So, but in clinic, it's not all the dementias are Alzheimer's. So you have to have the very defined pathological changes,
okay,
such as amyloid in the brain. So only after you satisfy all those different criteria, the person can be diagnosed as Alzheimer's disease, not only the cognitive decline.
When it comes to Alzheimer's, what are some of the symptoms that people might see as it starts to come on?
So although we say cognitive decline is very kind of signature, right? So they have dementia, but interesting, at the very early stage, a lot of that being observed is actually more or less like psychiatric side of change.
Okay.
So like the personality change, for example, and like agitation, and also like sleep disorders. So you have a lot of, it's really a variety of presentations in clinic.
Okay.
A lot of those actually are related to changes in brain neurodegenerative system, which is our interest. So in the brain there is this system, although the neurons is only not many by number, but they send out in brainstem, the neurons actually localized, but they send out a wide projections to the whole brain to regulate the response to external stimuli, and fight or flight, those kind of response, and they regulate cognition and sleep, even cardiovascular functions. This is really a whole body, state, the whole thing. So at very early time, those neurons, they are super sensitive to the amyloid toxicity. So they got attacked and start to degenerate first. And that caused a lot of trouble, like what I mentioned related to personality change or mood change, sleep problem,
okay,
all those actually are related to alterations in that system. Yeah, so now we found actually, with this early alteration, right, and you have actually the receptor activation is a critical step, make the transition from a normal physiological to disease state. So that's basically our discovery.
You joined UAB back in 2005, and that's right around the time that you got the interest in studying the brain a little bit.
Right.
Why did you choose UAB to come to after being at Iowa for a few years?
So I got my PhD at University of Iowa, and then I moved to Vanderbilt, actually, did my postdoc training there. So after I, trained there, spent 5 years at Vanderbilt, and, it's time for us to look for an independent job. My husband is, Kai is also a scientist.
Okay.
He's now a professor in genetics. So both of us want to look for a good home for our independent career. UAB is a great place. I mean, I think the biggest attraction here is the environment. So it's really a collaborative environment and for young scientists to grow.
How long had you been studying this and looking at this when you finally realized, we're onto something?
We studied, about like a little over 10 years ago, we started this project. We got some initial, about 6 years ago, we published our first paper about how this receptor activation can actually enhance the generation of those amyloid beta. So, which is a culprit of Alzheimer's disease. So at that time we thought, that's interesting, right? So if you have this receptor super active, you can make more amyloid, and we know they're toxic. But by then, back to 6 years ago, we still don't know this receptor can do more than that. We started to dig more because I have a background on molecular pharmacology. We study those receptors, their pharmacological properties. Then we noticed that if you have amyloid present, that will change the receptor function. So that with that we start to realize that this is more interesting than what we found.
For the average person, what are you looking at when you're looking at the amyloid?
So for Alzheimer's disease, right? So amyloid, you can consider it as like a trigger.
Okay.
So, and then there's another protein called tau. So basically in Alzheimer's disease patients in their brain, they have those amyloid plaques, aggregates, and also they have this tau tangles. And these two are two hallmarks for Alzheimer's disease. So the tau protein is actually an interesting protein. You can consider that as a bullet. So that's the one actually can hit the neuron and cause a neural damage.
Okay.
So you will have to have amyloid to trigger the bullet to hit it on neurons. So this is generally you can think about it in that way. So the amyloid, that's also related to the significance of our study, right? So people know, tau can be triggered by amyloid, right?
Mm-hmm.
But we don't know how. And our study actually discovered this neurodegenerative system, this receptor signaling is actually the critical link between amyloid and tau. With this kind of mechanism, you don't need a lot of amyloid.
Okay.
So just a little bit. So basically, this mechanism increases the sensitivity of tau to amyloid by like almost 100-fold. So you just need a little bit of amyloid nanomolar range to induce this whole toxic cascade, actually.
At what point in the process did you realize this link that you discovered maybe something that could be worked on and help out?
Right, yeah. So once we find out the concentration of amyloid we need to induce tau pathology, we realized that this concentration is so much lower than what had been published.
Okay.
Or people have been have thought. And then we really think we hit on something can explain a lot of, mysteries in Alzheimer's. You know, one thing is, so people know amyloid is a bad thing, right? So then we have a lot of trials, have been targeting this amyloid. So we just remove it and then we hopefully can solve the problem. But in people, right, human patients, you give them the antibodies to remove amyloid, you can really the best probably like 50% maybe the plaques, you can reduce that. You indeed can clear it up a lot. But with this new discovery, this discovered mechanism, right? As long as you still have like 1 or 2% left, that's almost impossible to achieve actually with the antibody. But still, that's sufficient to induce this toxicity anyway. So that explains why we have those trials failed. Also, as I said, those GPCRs, right? So those receptors, they are drug targets. So there are blockers, against those receptors. So we tested a blocker,
okay.
And then we found that we treat those inhibitors to block those receptors. We can reduce their tau pathology. We can improve their cognitive function in two different models. So now we are ready to do clinical trials because those drug, this particular drug actually being developed and tested in human, basically is pretty safe. It didn't get to FDA approval because it was tested for major depression, but the efficacy there was not significant enough. So I think it will be very promising if we can test this drug in AD patients.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something we plan to do to collaborate with physicians to pursue that.
For people that aren't really familiar with the entire process, working with the NIH, getting funding,
right?
Are we talking a matter of months for this, or are we talking years?
Okay, right, exactly.
With 10 years worth of work already in this,
right.
And now you're putting that much more. At what point do you kind of look and say, you know what? We've done something and we are really getting somewhere because we're still a little while away from clinical trials.
Right. I have to say, based on our current result or, what we have already learned, we're pretty confident, this is a important mechanism for Alzheimer's. For, as I said, it's always a long way to go. And especially for drug development, particularly, that takes years of testing.
Mm-hmm.
But I would say with this particular drug, it's actually already put us a lot ahead. So I would say probably within another, 3-4 years maybe, if everything works out and we might get some, initial human results. That I think will be very exciting. And at the same time, we are actually also doing more of the screening to look for more inhibitors, especially the selected ones, because this drug can have, side effects. We expect to have more, improved therapeutic efficacy, but limited side effects, hopefully. That's also something we're currently trying to do. Yeah.
Along the way, what was maybe the biggest challenge that you faced over the last 10 years in finding this breakthrough?
Doing science is always challenges, right? I find a lot of things very important to get to, any progress. You have to have, of course, funding support,
yep.
Right? And you have to have dedicated people. which, you know, I really appreciate it, you know. And, you know, you have to have great collaborators as well. So those are all, I would say, necessary, I have to say. Yeah, so, and it's always hard to really find out, to make a scientific discovery, you know, so a lot of frustrations, but that's what we do, I guess.
When you made this discovery, did you have a chance to sit back and celebrate a little bit, or was it work as usual and back at figuring this out and fine-tuning it?
So it's actually, to us, it's just something we do, you know, routinely. It's great, you know, we made a big discovery and, you know, get, you know, people in the field excited. But at the same time, that's a routine as well. So you still come to work, come to the lab and do, you know, what we do regularly and hope to, you know, move the study further.
How close do you think we are to finding a breakthrough that kind of wipes out Alzheimer's?
Well, you know, the NIH has this goal to cure Alzheimer's by 2025. There are so many researchers are working in this Alzheimer's field, and the NIH have this, great mechanism to attract newcomers to join the field. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty optimistic, and some great breakthrough will happen.
Where will Qin Wang be 15, 20 years down the road?
I just hope, you know, we can further expand our research program, make more important discoveries, it seems hard to to see through like 15 years later. But I would say, with all the support, I'm also recruiting new people in the lab and expanding the lab. I'm pretty optimistic for our next 15 years.
What will people say about Alzheimer's disease in 15 years?
I hope we have a cure. I hope at that time we can have drugs to or ways. Not one or single drug, maybe a cocktail or something to support people, you know, to like have some kind of prevention ways, you know, so at a certain age we know, or we have a better screen, you know, method, and then we can tell people who are at the risk, higher risk, and then we can give them some kind of cocktail to prevent the disease, because the whole society is aging. I think that's important, you know, if we can interfere early so people can have their normal cognitive function for a long age, and then can live a better life.
Dr. Wang will continue trying to put the pieces of the Alzheimer's puzzle in place. She joined UAB as an assistant professor in 2005. Dr. Wang's primary appointment is as professor in the Department of Cell, Developmental and Integrative Biology Department, but she also works with the Alzheimer Disease Center, Comprehensive Diabetes Center, and Center for Biophysical Science and Engineering. Having been part of the UAB community for a decade and a half, Qin has her own unique perspective of what it means to be a blazer.
It's a collaborative way. Yeah, so I see a lot of collaboration and people support each other. I think that's important.
Stay on top of all of our podcasts by subscribing to UAB Green and Told wherever you listen, or visit us at alumni.uab.edu/greenandtold. Have an idea for a future episode? We'd love to hear from you. Email me at greenandtold@uab.edu. And don't forget to follow us on social media. We can be found at UAB Alumni on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thanks for listening, and until next time, go Blazers!